Lord, we're so grateful for all that you've done for us through your Son and your salvation offered freely by your grace. We thank you for your church and the opportunity to study tonight, Hebrews 9. And I pray that we would get a better understanding of the work you've accomplished to provide a better religion for Israel and help us have talking points and sound doctrine in our minds to communicate to those who are stuck in religion so that we can explain your better things. Amen. Okay. Hebrews chapter 9 tonight. I'm going to do a little review of the last few verses of Hebrews 8. Thank you for staying over last week and studying the new covenant with me. It's a very important part, so I don't want to make light of it by not spending ample time with it. So we'll hit it a little bit again today and hopefully get through most of Hebrews 9 and then finish Hebrews 9 next week. Okay. And I hope you're appreciating the last couple chapters, and then tonight and next week as well, the teaching in Hebrews 7 through 10 here, that's talking about the shadows and the figures in Israel's Old Testament and how they foreshadowed things to come, specifically Jesus, Israel's Christ, and the heavenly tabernacle and their kingdom to come. So all those things in Israel's history in the Old Testament, there are certain things back there that were shadows of these things to come. Hebrews, being a book describing things to come, explains the fulfillment of the shadows. That's what the book of Hebrews is. Without the book of Hebrews, we don't have a book explaining that. Okay, so that should tell you in the Bible where and why Hebrews is important. Without Hebrews, we don't know that. Now, we said a similar thing about the book of Acts. Take the book of Acts out, you don't know what happened between Jesus ascending and Paul. How did Paul get in the scene? Same thing with Hebrews. If you don't have the book of Hebrews, what you have is a nation in a temple doing the Old Testament sacrifices, service, and ministry. How do you get from there to Christ in Israel's system? Well, Hebrews explains that. Okay, Hebrews explains how Christ fulfills and provides a better thing for Israel. So most specifically, Hebrews provides, as I said in my prayer, a better religion for Israel. Israel was the only religious nation God established, the only religion that he established was with the nation of Israel. And a religion, of course, is that system of works and rituals and things you perform in order to make yourself satisfactory before God. That's a religion. And so the Old Testament was definitely that, a religion, and it was the only one God ordained. There are many other religions in the world, and none of them can compare to Israel's new covenant. And so Hebrews explains the replacement of Israel's old religion with this new covenant religion. Now, of course, the new covenant is grace, I understand that, but included in the new covenant is still priests and tabernacles and sacrifices. It's simply a better system of priests, sacrifices, and tabernacles, okay? And that's what we're learning in Hebrews. Instead of a Levitical priest, you've got Christ, the Melchizedekan priest. Instead of goats and animals, you have Christ himself being the sacrifice. Instead of an earthly tabernacle, you have the tabernacle in heaven. And so you see there's still those elements. And so thus there was still this religious, it's still a fulfillment of of God's instituted religion, only it's fulfilled in Christ, okay? So when we're talking to people in the world who are religious and have their religious systems, understanding Hebrews is significant. It's still an important book for that. Even though it's not to the church today, and we know something that excels the new covenant for Israel, we have something called the mystery that explains God's dispensation of grace, Hebrews deals with religion on religion's turf. You understand? It deals with religion on where they come from. They say, well, we've got priests and we've got confession and sacrifice. Well, Hebrews says we've got a better sacrifice, better priests, better temples. Paul doesn't even deal with that business. He's talking to Gentiles, some of them very irreligious, and deals with the fact that we're all sinners and no religion at all could do anything to save anybody. And so he explains very plainly how Christ alone and his blood alone and grace alone is the only way that anybody can be saved. And of course, that fits in with the new covenant as well. The new covenant provides grace for Israel, provides salvation for them. And so I hope you appreciate what Hebrews is in explaining to us, how Israel has this better thing, okay, this better religion, this better covenant than what they had before. And so, in Hebrews chapter 8, that's what Hebrews 8 verse 6 is talking about, how that he obtained a more excellent ministry, by how much also he's the mediator of a better covenant, which is established upon better promises. And so instead of teaching like Paul would, that, you know, you're strangers of covenants. You were never given the earthly promises. You're not priests. Hebrews says there's a better one. Okay, so it's a different approach to that. And so Hebrews 8 through 12 quotes Jeremiah 31, and we covered this last week, talking about the prophecy of Israel's new covenant. And we summarized Jeremiah 31 and that new covenant as simply being Israel's salvation. If you don't know anything else about the new covenant, understand the new covenant is Israel's salvation. That's how they were going to get salvation. The Old Testament could not save Israel. You know that under grace, because the law is the knowledge of sin, and the law can't justify anybody. Okay, so you know that. And so even in Israel's Old Testament, we covered Deuteronomy 5 and 6 and Deuteronomy 30 last week and Jeremiah 31, Ezekiel 36, and how all these Old Testament passages deal with the better system that was going to replace the Old Testament law. And so Hebrews then is explaining this. So the new covenant is Israel's salvation. It's the way they were going to obtain forgiveness. It's how they were going to obtain the promises they were given. It's how they were going to obtain salvation. Where people get confused is they see that, oh, we get salvation too, don't we? And aren't we forgiven? And don't we get God's grace? Well, yes, you do. You just don't get it through Israel's new covenant. You get it through this mystery of Christ. You get it through Christ, through grace. Okay. And so, of course, Romans 11, 27, Paul says the same thing. In Romans 9 through 11, he talks about how Israel did not receive their promises during Paul's ministry because they had rejected Christ by faith. And so they had fallen. In Romans 11, he talks about Israel's fall. And in Romans 11, 25, he says it's a mystery that Israel has fallen. They're blind until the time the Gentiles comes in, the fullness of the Gentiles comes in. And so he's saying that Israel's blind in this dispensation. They've fallen until this future time. And then Romans 11, 26, he says, and that's when God's covenant will be fulfilled with them. It says, this is my covenant with them when I shall take away their sins. And so Romans 11, Paul's talking about Israel and their program and how God's going to take away their sins in the future. That's their new covenant, okay? Their sins don't get forgiven under the old covenant, under the new covenant, Romans 11, 27 says. Look at 1 Peter chapter 1. I know we covered a couple of these verses last week, but again, I just want this to be, you to be reminded about it because it's so important for understanding the entire book of Hebrews and what it's talking about. And 1 Peter 1, Peter, of course, being one of the 12 apostles and being then in the context of the audience that the book of Hebrews is written to, and Hebrews even mentions Peter, not by name necessarily, but by the group of people who ministered with the Lord in Hebrews 2. In 1 Peter 1, verse 5, Peter says, writing to that little flock of Israel, excuse me, in 2 Peter here, 1 Peter 1, verse 5, it says that they have an inheritance in verse 4. And in verse 5, they're kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. That's the same thing Paul said in Romans 11, 27, how that Israel shall be forgiven of their sins. They will be saved in the future. Well, Peter here is writing that in his epistle to that little flock. He says, you have salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. He's not saying you have salvation now. Okay, that's the difference between the new covenant for Israel in the future and you according to the mystery today. In 1 Peter 1, verse 9, Peter says that, in verse 6 rather, it's nice just to read through this passage because in verse 6 he says, wherein ye greatly rejoice, though now for a season, if need be, ye are in heaviness through manifold temptations. So in verse 6, he says, you have salvation in the end, but now in this season, you're going through these temptations. That was Hebrews 3 and 4. In verse 7, that the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perishes, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. So see, the audience of Peter's audience here, is going through this time of tribulation and trial of fire, and he's exhorting them that their faith would be found, unto praise and honor when Jesus comes back. In verse 8, whom having not seen, ye love, in whom though now ye see him not, yet believing, you rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory. Well, why do they do that? Because they know the content of Hebrews. They understand Christ is their priest, is their Messiah. So in verse 9, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls. And so again, he's talking about the end there and how their salvation will come in the end when they enter into that rest, when the kingdom finally comes, when salvation comes. Of course, Peter's the guy that taught in Acts 3:19 that they need to repent, you know, because the Lord's in heaven and he'll return and their sins may be blotted out at the time of refreshing. And so Peter's the one that says they have future forgiveness if they repent and trust in Jesus. But in verse 10, it says, of which salvation the prophets have inquired and searched diligently, who prophesied of the grace that should come unto you. And so there's grace that's going to come again at the end. Read verse 13. Gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and hope to the end for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. So there's a quick go through of this passage in 1 Peter, and it's good for you to put little stars next to those or highlight those in your thinking, because Peter addresses the same thing in Hebrews, that their salvation, their forgiveness, their grace is promised to them, and they have a surety of it, but they don't yet have it. It's in the future, you see. And so they've got that mortgage. I mean, they're in the house, but you know, it's not paid off. It's not complete until the future comes, until the Christ returns. And here's where Hebrews is at. Hebrews is exhorting the audience of Hebrews that they have salvation and forgiveness if they continue in this to the end. Okay? And so in Hebrews chapter 8, in verse 10, this is the covenant I will make with the house of Israel after those days. That's why I say the new covenant is salvation for Israel, because the new covenant was made with Israel and only Israel. House of Israel, after those days, saith the Lord, I will put my laws in their mind, write them in their hearts, and I will be to them a God, and they shall be to me a people. So the fact that he's going to write the laws in their minds and their hearts, the point of that was that they would do them. You see, the old covenant did not write the law in their hearts. It wrote them on stones, and that didn't make them do them. They didn't make them want to do them. They just saw them, you know. But the laws in their hearts, when God softens their hearts and gives them a new heart and gives them a new spirit in Ezekiel 36 and writes the laws in there so that they desire to do them and has the spirit enablement to perform them, that's the point of writing the law in their hearts, that they keep the law. And so when you read that, we can't spiritualize that and say, well, we have the law, meaning the Bible, in our hearts. No. That is the actual law that has been changed to the new covenant that they're going to perform. And by performing that law, when the new covenant is fulfilled, they're going to be that glory and ministry of the Lord on the earth, okay, by keeping it. And so that's why it's better than the old, is that the law is in their mind, in their hearts, not on tablets of stone, okay? You, rather, are not under the law. They still have a law inactive. And so for Israel, this is great. I mean, the old religion was do or don't do. You be blessed or you be cursed. The new covenant is, I'm going to make you do. I'm going to cause you. I'm going to give you the ability to do, you see. So that's much better. That's a better system, okay? So moving on, it says, he'll be to them a God and to me a people. They shall be to me a people. Again, people spiritualize this and say, well, we're God's people today in the church. Only the verse says, I'll be to them a God, and the them is defined in Jeremiah 31 as Israel. Once again, we saw that last week. And so if the to them a God is speaking about the church, then why is it to them? Why is it that specific group? Is he not a God to anyone else? You see, I mean, this is the strange thing today. Today, God is offering salvation to all freely. So whose God is he? You see, well, everybody's rejected him, and he's offering salvation to all. But he was the Father and God of Israel, and when they have the laws in their hearts and obey his commandments, that's when he will be to them a God, and they, Israel, will be to him a people. And that's the promise that he gave Abraham, that the nation from your family will be my people, my nation. Okay. So if this is the church, then you can forget dispensational Bible study. If this is the church, the people here, and to them a God, that's talking about the church, then forget dispensational Bible study. Dispensational Bible study rightly divides Israel from the church. And if that's the church, there's no division anymore. Apparently, we are Israel, and we're either spiritual Israel or replacement Israel or somehow, you know, receiving Israel's promises. So there's no difference. There's no dispensational difference. Okay. So we might as well close the door there. In verse 11, they shall not teach every man his neighbor, and every man his brother, saying, know the Lord, for all shall know me, from the least to the greatest. And that verse forbids evangelism, apparently. It forbids evangelism. How do you know the Lord today? How does anybody know the Lord today? It's through teaching and preaching, right? This verse says in the New Covenant, You shall not teach every man his neighbor, for they shall all know the Lord. You say, they're all going to know him. So this means it cannot be happening today when we're instructed today to teach and to preach. And then down in verse 12, I will be merciful to their unrighteousness, and their sins and their iniquities will I remember no more. Now think about that. Now we have grace provided to us freely, where all of our sins have been forgiven through the finished work of Jesus Christ. And trespasses are not being imputed unto us today in 2 Corinthians 5. Some people take in 2 Corinthians 5 that verse where God's not imputing trespasses and make it so that he will never impute trespasses ever again. And that's just wrong thinking, because that's not what the verse says. He was not imputing trespasses when they killed his son on the cross. He was not imputing trespasses, else God would have judged him right then and there. And that's the worst crime in history. Okay, so he was not imputing it to them at that time. But will he come back and judge all men? Yes, is the answer. And so if this verse says, in the new covenant, I will remember no more their sins, does this mean the tribulation and the judgment's called off? If that's happening today, no more will he remember. That's not what Paul says in 2 Corinthians 5. He simply says he's not imputing trespasses today. But that's going to end in this dispensation of grace when it's over. Okay, and then there'll be tribulation, and then there'll be God's judgment on the world, and God's judgment of all the dead, and then there'll be the millennium, then eternity, in which there'll be no more sin. The only place you can put that verse is after God has judged the world. And then he could say, not going to remember that anymore. Okay, so he's not going to remember their sin anymore when this is fulfilled, after that tribulation, after those judgments. All right, and so that's where the new covenant is complete and is finished. This cannot be talking about the church today. And I know there's similarities, but we have to make that distinction. The new covenant was better than the old, but it's not the mystery. So I wrote in the article on Saturday simply that you need to distinguish between the new covenant and the mystery, because if you don't, your riches in Christ Jesus can be robbed from you. The riches you have that are unsearchable, not found in the prophets. That means they're not part of the new covenant. The riches that you can be saved now in an earthen vessel, even though you have a body of sin, that body of sin has been separated spiritually from you so that you're complete in Christ today. You have forgiveness now, you've got grace now, all grace now, it's all sufficient, and you're saved and complete in Christ. These people have a covenant and a promise of that, but their forgiveness comes in the future. Their grace comes in the future. Their salvation comes in the future, all provided by Christ. Okay, so that's the context. That's what you need to know about this new covenant teaching. I almost want to ask if there's any questions about that, because I'm going to move on to a totally different topic now. Is there any questions about that? No, we're good. Good. So Hebrews 9, as we start this new chapter, it's going to explain then some more about this better covenant and the better service and better sanctuary that comes along with it. It says, then verily the first covenant had also ordinances of divine service and a worldly sanctuary. For there was a tabernacle made the first, or the tabernacle made the first, wherein was the candlestick and the table. It goes on to explain this. And so what it's going to do through this chapter is really compare the two different things in Israel's old religion and their new covenant. Okay, there's going to be two priests. We've already studied about the two priests in Hebrews 7. Remember that? There was the Levitical priests. Then there's the priest after Melchizedek. So there's two priests. There's two covenants. We just saw that in Hebrews 8. Very clearly, it was the old covenant and the new covenant, the difference there. There's going to be two tabernacles. There's the earthly one in the Jerusalem that then was. Then there's this other tabernacle, this other heavenly holy place. There's going to be two services. The first covenant had a divine service that God ordained that they perform these things. And it's the same way in this heavenly Jerusalem, this heavenly tabernacle, where God ordains these things to happen. Okay? There's two mediators. There's a mediator of the old covenant, mediator of the new covenant. And there's two sacrifices, one in the old and then the one in the new. And of course, the new, on all these counts, are better. And so this is what Hebrews 9 is explaining, this difference, this comparison. All right. So in Hebrews 9, 1 through 5, really 1 through 7 there, simply describes the first of those two things. It describes the Old Testament, and not completely in detail, because there's dozens of chapters. I think someone said once 50 or 60 chapters in the Old Testament dealing with the temple and the construction of those things in the temple. And so, anybody studied the temple in Exodus back there on your own a little bit? Maybe you know some of it. Well, if not, then we'll go through it briefly here, just because the text does. But Hebrews 9, verse 1 says there's the divine service and worldly sanctuary. And that's what it's going to describe. And it starts out describing this tabernacle that was made. And the tabernacle, if we can draw it like this, was divided into two sections. Actually, one was a little smaller than that. Okay. And of course, we're talking about here that tabernacle in the wilderness, okay, that God instructed Moses to build, and it was portable. They can build it and take it with them as they wander through the wilderness. And I'm giving you an aerial view here of this tabernacle, this tent, in which there was a gate, rather a tent gate, where they walked in the front there, and there was a altar where I'll draw some flames, where they burnt the sacrifices here at the altar. And then you go a little further, and there's this bowl where they had water. That was the laver, where the priests would wash themselves before they entered into this holy place, which they called the tabernacle, the tent of the tabernacle. So here was just a wall, just around here. You can see in here if you looked over the wall. But here was a tent. So all across the top of this thing, and at the bottom, it was a tent like this. So you couldn't see in there at all. Of course, there was a tent in the front, and of course, you couldn't get in the back. That was all closed off. So the priests would do this service here. And so people would come from Israel, and they lived in their tents around the tabernacle here. And they would come into the tent with their sacrifices, and there'd be priests here, and they'd offer their animal sacrifices on this altar, right? And then according to what sacrifice they were offering, there were some 5 or 6 different sacrifices in the Old Testament. The burnt offering, I practice that quite frequently in the kitchen. And then there's the sin offering, the guilt offering, the peace offering, the I'm missing one. Someone know my heart? There's a fellowship offering. There's different offerings. And what's interesting about that, as you study them, there's 5 of them in total, is that not all of them are for sins, okay? There's a peace offering, for example, or another one was called a feast offering, where you would come, and it wasn't because of sin. It was just because you wanted to have fellowship with God. You would offer this offering, and they wouldn't burn it all. You would actually split it. It was like a meal. The priests would eat it, and you and your company that you're offering it would eat it. It's like a meal with God. Okay, and that was one of the offerings. Another one was an offering where you'd come, and it was a grain offering, and you'd provide it, and again, that was a meal for the priests. And so it's like, here's a peace offering to God. It's just praising God because he's our God, and you give a peace offering. And the priest used that to eat, and that was part of their grocery list, right? But that was, again, another offering. It had nothing to do with sins. There was one called a burnt offering, which, again, wasn't a sin offering, where you'd come, and this one was burnt, but you'd give an offering where the whole thing would be burned up to God. The whole thing. No one eats it. Not the priest, not the people. And like, what's that all about? Well, that had to do with consecration and dedication of everything to the Lord. It's all the Lord's, right? So again, this is this praiseworthy offering to God, okay? So it's really only a couple of those offerings that were sin sacrifices, where they would come, and there was a specific way to do that, and it was for the atonement of sins, and you'd lay your hand on the animal, and the priest would say some words over this, and then that would be for an atonement for sins, your sins. So thus the confession, and then the sacrifice, okay? But anyway, that's not in the lesson tonight. That's just all for your benefit and how that sacrificial system worked. Okay, but people who walked in, the Israelites who walked in to offer these sacrifices, they would, you know, for the sin sacrifices, lay their hands on those animals. So it's not the priest that's in their place, that they're actually coming and saying, I'm offering a sin offering, and this is the animal that, you know, I'm killing for my sin offering. So that there was that education of them. But the priest, after they offer these sacrifices, would come back, and before they entered into this holy place, which only the priest could enter, they would wash their hands, and thus you had all sorts of diverse washings and things. And the priest would come into this tabernacle, which is divided into 2 places, separated by veils or curtains. There was a curtain up front here and a thicker one back here, okay, in 2 compartments. In the first place you come in, on the north side, you had this table in which there were 12 cakes. If you see pictures of them, they're like giant pancakes, only they're unleavened bread, and they're stacked in stacks of 6. So there's 6 here and 6 there, 12 cakes, 12 breads, showbreads, what they were called, 1 for each tribe of Israel. So they look like a wedding cake, only without the icing and all that stuff. You know, just, they're just sitting there, along with some incense and some liquid. Okay, it's a table, the table of showbread. And that bread was supposed to be there in the presence of the Lord who dwelt in this holy place forever. Okay, so the bread would be there all the time. On the other side of this showbread was what you all have seen in maybe the celebration of Hanukkah or whatnot, is the menorah, which was the solid gold candlestick with 7 lamps at the top. That was filled with olive oil and supposed to burn perpetually before the Lord, Leviticus 24. Right before this giant veil was an altar, and this altar was the altar of incense, where the priest would come in and lay incense down on here, and it would go up for a sweet smell to the Lord, sweet savor to the Lord. And so only the priests did this activity inside this tent. People would come in and offer animals here, and they would sacrifice the animals, and the priests would help them with that. No, but only priests would come in here to the holy place and do this divine service where they could eat with the Lord, and where they would shine the light in here, and they would offer incense to the Lord. None of the priests, save one, could come back here. And back here was a room that was separate. The only thing in this room was this Ark of the Covenant, in which you had these giant cherubs with their wings covering this mercy seat that was the top of the Ark of the Covenant. Okay? And this was left alone all year except for one day in which the high priest, after they performed these responsibilities here and after there was a sacrifice offered, the high priest alone would come into this holiest place and he would offer the blood of a sacrifice here on the mercy seat once a year. And of course, if any of this they did wrongly, the wrong time, with the wrong sacrifice, they could either be cut off or killed. Okay, God punished him by death. So the high priest couldn't come in here any other day. No one else can come in here unless they die. Of course, all this was portable, so God was ahead of the times, and you can all pack this up, and you got rods and everything, and you can carry them around the wilderness. Okay, but this was their tabernacle system. So Hebrews 9 says there was a tabernacle made, and there was two places. The first place here, this is the first place, and this is the second place. Okay, the first place, it says, wherein was the candlestick here, and the table, and the showbread, which is over here. It doesn't mention the altar of incense, but I just threw that in there for you to understand. Okay? And it says, this is called the sanctuary. The sanctuary, that thing, that place that is set apart, separated. This is separated from not only all of Israel, but even this place out here. It's a sanctuary. All right? That's interesting, because churches call the room that we're in a sanctuary. Why is that? It couldn't be, because some people preach that we're all priests now, the priest of all believers, and we're all doing divine service in the altars in here. Surely that couldn't be. Surely there's not a table up front that says, you know, this is the Lord's table, and there's an altar call. No one talks like this in church, do they? All the time. And so you see, churches are very religious and take a pattern from Israel's system. And of course, it's different and that sort of thing, but it's the same type of thing. There's a sanctified, separate place, and what's done in here, you can't do out there. You come into here, you have church clothes, church talk, church. This is special. You can't have any defilement in this place, right? We know by grace, of course, that that's nonsense today. We're not under the law. There is no sanctuary in earth, you see. Not only do we learn that in Hebrews now, in the New Covenant, but according to the mystery, there's no sanctified place. There's no sanctified people. This is sanctified by grace, and that's you. You're the temple of the Holy Spirit. So if you're the temple, and your body is, that makes a whole new interpretation of what you should and shouldn't defile. It has nothing to do with this building. It has to do with you. You know, but that's another lesson for another day. So in Hebrews 9 here, it just describes all this, okay? And of course, all of these things, since we learn in Hebrews 9, are figures and types and shadows of things to come, have very interesting things about them if you study them. Okay? A lot of these things are applicable to learning about Israel's future. Right? For example, there's 12 loaves here, right? And what did Jesus say when he came in the book of John, when he preached to the nation of Israel? What did he say to them? He said, I am, and he said that 7 times, I am the bread of life. Right? Why would that make any difference? Why did he choose? Why didn't he say, I am the spaghetti monster of life? You know, why didn't he say that? That would be more apt in the 21st century. That's because they knew what the showbread was like. They knew what that was for. It was in a holy place, you see. And what's interesting, you read Ezekiel 41 back there in that temple in the millennium, the 1,000 years. There'll be a temple built in Jerusalem. There's a table of the Lord. And the Lord is actually there at that table. Now, he's actually back here too, only he's... You know, he's invisible, right? But in Ezekiel 41, Jesus is there sitting at the table of the Lord, and the priests come in and offer the sacrifices, and they eat with the Lord. That's interesting. So they're there, they're offering before the Lord's table in their tabernacle in Ezekiel 40 through 48 is where you read about that. It's interesting, okay? In the Old Testament, the priests would come in here once a week and change the bread. So that every Sabbath they'd come in, put new breads there, showbreads, okay, in the Lord's presence. They'd sprinkle some incense on them, right? And they'd sit there all week. At the end of the week, they'd come in and they'd eat them. Of course, they'd replace them and eat them. So the priest would eat them in the presence of the Lord. Of course, he's invisible, right? In the kingdom, Jesus will actually be there, all right? This lamp here, the light. What did Jesus say in the book of John when he came to Israel? What did he call himself? I am the light, right? Wonder where he got that. From the temple here, right? He is the light. And so Israel had a responsibility to fill this lamp, not with wax, but with, anybody know, olive oil, right? So they had olives from olive trees in which they made light to fill this candlestick, and that light had to burn continually. Could never go out, all right? And so that was part of the priestly duty, to make sure that light didn't go out, make sure you trim the wicks and make sure you put more oil in it, this sort of thing. And so when Romans 11 talks about olive trees, and whether you're bearing fruit or not, I wonder what that's talking about. Jesus Christ is the light, and Israel's supposed to bear fruit and keep that olive lamp going, and branches are being broken off because they don't have fruit. That's interesting. Why isn't it an olive tree? Why not an apple tree? Yeah. Well, because Israel had to do with olives. That was part of their divine service. And by the way, both those trees, Romans 11, are olive trees. This incense over here, a lot of places in the Bible equate incense with prayer. David says that. He said, let my prayers be like incense to you as they go up and I pray to you in heaven. Okay, Revelation 5 is the same thing where there's an angel there and he's offering the prayers of the saints with incense, like incense to God. They're kind of floating up to God. Revelation 5. But Exodus 30 talks about this incense. And what's interesting, have you ever heard the idea of people praying or doing devotions in the morning and the evening? You hear about this? You ever think about like where this came from? Okay, well, in Israel's religious system, this was the thing they did every morning and evening. They would offer a sacrifice every day, every morning and evening. Then they'd come in here and offer incense every morning and evening. In the morning, they'd offer incense. In the evening, they'd offer incense. So the altar of incense here was a sweet smell to the Lord, and the incense that they made, the recipes in the Old Testament, no one else could wear that perfume. No one else could do it. If they did, they're in trouble with God. It was only a smell you can smell in this holy place. It was God's smell, sanctified smell. Nah, a sanctified smell. And God told Israel it had to be burnt twice a day. And so they did that with all the spices, and there were people that made the spices. And so, yeah, ever ask what the priests did? It wasn't just killing animals. There's a lot to do here. I mean, they're making bread, they're getting the ingredients for the bread, they're making the olive oil, they're coming with the incense. I mean, they're doing this service all the time, every day. I mean, there's lots of responsibility here. And all of this was a figure, was a picture to describe things to come. Okay, these were shadows of things to come. And so this altar of incense was right before, right in front of this heavy veil between this place here. And the reason why it was over here was so that when the priest came in here through the Holy of Holies, when he opened that curtain ever so slightly to go in there, you know, that what is God's smell when he comes in? You know, I don't know what happens at your house. At my house in the restroom, there's something that smells good, right? And you spray there. Why? So when you open the door and you go out, it's fine, right? This is a similar idea with the temple. Not to be base and gross, but that was the idea. Okay, the idea was that these people stink to God. Okay, really, this is quite literally what it was. And so here, right next to God, where God met with even the priest. I mean, these weren't like the regular folks. These were priests. There was altar of incense. Okay, what else is there? Light, continual light, and food, where they can dwell and commune with God. That's where the priest would have the privilege of being there with God. Okay, when the priest went in here, he didn't just burn incense. He had his own censer. And Hebrews chapter 9 says that in verse 3, after the second veil, the tabernacle, which is called the holiest of all. It's interesting. I was studying this, and I don't remember ever coming into this problem before, but I discovered it during my study, and perhaps this is new to you as well. You ever heard this called the Holy of Holies? You know it's not in your King James Bible? Anywhere. It's not called the Holy of Holies. It is in the New American Standard, and it is in the NIV a few times. No, not the NIV, the Darby translation a few times. The Darby translation, which I think is where people popularize it, because the Darbyites do a lot of study on these types. But in the King James Bible, it's not called the Holy of Holies. It's called the holiest of all in Hebrews 9, verse 3. Or in back in the Old Testament, it's called the most holy place. So this is the holy place, and this is the most holy place. It's just an interesting tidbit to keep in mind there. But in any sense, the Holy of Holies, the most holy, it is the most holy place. So where the tabernacle here was sanctified from the nation, and here the holy place was sanctified even in the tabernacle, this is the most holy place separated by this veil, even from where the priest could enter. So only one priest, the high priest, can go in here. The only thing in here was this Ark of the Covenant. Okay, and I told you that the priest, the high priest, when he went in once a year, he took a golden censer with him, a little golden plate of incense that was burning, so that even when he came in with his head bowed and sandals off his feet, he's got this incense, this smell before the Lord. Okay? And it says in verse 4, he had the golden censer and the Ark of the Covenant overlaid round about with gold, wherein was the golden pot that had manna and Aaron's rod that budded and the tables of the covenant. You know what the tables of covenant are. Those are Moses' tables of stone, which he wrote the commandments on. You probably know what the manna was, the bread that God gave Israel. Apparently, there was a bowl of it that they had collected that had not gone bad, even though the manna they collected in the wilderness went bad every day. This manna didn't. It was in the Ark of the Covenant. And the third thing was a stick, was a rod, when in the Old Testament wilderness where they were questioning Aaron's right to be a priest. Remember that number 17, I think I mentioned this to you before, where there were other people in Israel that said, hey, look, you know, we're no different. We're Israelites just like you, Aaron. You know, why can't we do the same things you do in here? I mean, why can't we all just do our own thing, just come in here and do the service? And so God let them put it to the test, and he said, all right, every family brings their own stick. They brought a stick, and they said, the one that buds, that's the one I've ordained. That's the one I've called to be the priest. And Aaron's was the only stick that budded. It was a stick, it wasn't a tree, it was dead, but it budded flowers. So they put that stick in the Ark of the Covenant just to remind Israel that Aaron was the one God chose and his family to be these priests that would enter this holy place. The rest of them were punished severely, but that's what's in here. You have this Ark of the Covenant filled with sticks and stones and bread. So breadsticks and sticks and stones and all that, that's what's in there, okay? It's interesting. So it's very carnal, very earthly, isn't it? What's in this Ark of that first covenant? The new covenant's very different, yet heavenly things, okay? But this is the idea of the most holy place. Now, what's interesting, I told you there's a tent, a giant cloth covering this entire place from the ceiling to the floor and at the entranceway. So the only way you can come in here that you can see is with this lampstand right here, okay? Now, what's also interesting is that there's another curtain right here. So how are you supposed to see when you come in here? Well, first of all, no one went in there except for one high priest once a year. But how did he see when he got in there? Because he had some work to do. He went in here and he took the blood that he offered out here and he poured it on the mercy seat. Well, the idea was that God's glory was in there and God was there. He sat on that mercy seat and he lit that room. So the high priest would go in with his head bowed and it was light in there. Okay, and so that's the idea in the Old Testament, that God dwelt here. And of course, you see the picture of God with the cloud and the fire back in the wilderness that everyone can see sitting over this place. But when the high priest went in there, it was light. So that's a very interesting thing to think about. So there didn't need to be any lanterns in there because God's glory was there. But meanwhile, that's all extraneous to Hebrews chapter 9 here. Hebrews 9 verse 5 says that over it, over the Ark of the Covenant, were cherubims, which are not angels, and they're not imaginary. They're not little babies with wings. These are certain creatures that apparently are like honor guards or defenders of God's glory. They're always seen in the Old Testament around his throne, okay? They have four faces. They've got wings. Angels don't have wings. They were also, one of them was placed outside the entranceway to the Garden of Eden when Adam and Eve were kicked out. So they're warriors in a sense. They're defenders or guards. And the devil was a cherub. That was the anointed cherub, actually. And he fell, okay? So that's where Satan came from. But meanwhile, when they made the Ark of the Covenant, they made these giant golden cherubs over the mercy seat, which was the throne or the seat where God would sit. Okay, this is the only place in the New Testament you see that phrase mercy seat. Back in Hebrews chapter 4, remember we talked about approaching the throne of grace in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 16. This is the throne of grace that they're talking about here. And of course, not the earthly one, but the heavenly one. Okay, and so the mercy seat was a picture of the throne of grace. You don't approach the throne of grace, of course. You don't need a mercy seat because you have something greater than mercy, and you have something greater than just having access to grace when you ask for it. You have all-sufficient grace even when you don't ask for it. You see, you've got grace now already. It's all given to you. So when Paul asked for the Lord for something, the Lord said, my grace is sufficient for you. I've already given you all that you need. You have all grace. So very different, again, than what Hebrews is talking about. But this is their system, okay? So look down at Hebrews chapter 9, verse 5, there's the mercy seat, of which we cannot now speak particularly, which is interesting. I found a couple of accounts. One, it could be that he's talking about, you know, that there's a mercy seat and other things that we can't really say in detail because it was a secret place. Maybe he's saying there's more I have to say, but I don't have time to say it. Or it could be he's simply saying it because nobody had seen the Ark of the Covenant for centuries. The last time in the Bible you read about it, and the last time Israel had the Ark of the Covenant, was before the Babylonians came and destroyed Jerusalem and took them into captivity. And so after that, they don't know what happened to him. Some people theorize that Jeremiah took it and hid it. Some people say the Babylonians have it. Other people say, whatever happened to it. You know. No one had seen the Ark of the Covenant. And Jeremiah 3, verse 16, actually has an interesting prophecy. Because Jeremiah 3 says, Jeremiah was a prophet right before the Babylonians captured Israel. He said, there will be a time when no one will name the Ark of the Covenant. No one will talk about it. No one will see it. And that was a prophecy because the Babylonians came and no one saw it again. So Hebrews 9 here says, describing the mercy seat and the Ark of the Covenant, that he cannot speak particularly about it. In verse 6, now when these things were thus ordained, when God gave the law in some 50 chapters, says this is how you make that, this is how you make this, and this is the times, and who's going to do what, and he gave all those rules and those orders there. When these things were ordained, the priest went always into the first tabernacle, accomplishing the service of God. This is where the priest went in. So we've already talked about the Levitical priests and the Melchizedekan priest. Well, the priest went into the first tabernacle. In verse 7, but into the second, that's the most holy place, into the second went the high priest alone once every year. So it's not that the high priest went in there once forever. The high priest went in there once every year on the Day of Atonement and offered an atoning sacrifice for all of Israel's sins for that year. Okay? And it says in verse 6 that he accomplished the service of God. The high priest went in once every year, not without blood, which he offered for himself and for the heirs of the people. And you go back and read the Old Testament, actually, he goes in there twice. He goes in once for himself, and he comes back out and gets blood, and goes in again for the sins of the people. So it's one day, but he actually on that day goes in there twice for his own sins and for the sins of Israel. Okay, so that's describing simply the divine service of the worldly sanctuary of the Old Covenant. It's simply all that's been happening so far. He just describes it. Now in verse 8, he starts saying, and this is what that means, which is amazing. Because like I said, without the book of Hebrews, that's all we know. It's just, oh yeah, they used to do that. That's interesting. But Hebrews 8:8 suddenly starts saying, and this is what God was telling you. Okay, which is interesting. We cannot, and here's a warning before we get into this. We cannot start interpreting things in the Old Testament to apply to things in the New Testament unless the Bible tells us we can. Okay. There's many people who would like to say that everything in the Old Testament speaks about whatever they want to make it. Be careful of doing that, okay? When the Bible tells you that teaches us this, now it's safe to talk about that. So we studied that back in Genesis. Remember we talked about Joseph in Genesis? And how Joseph was a type of Jesus Christ. And that's just not something we just made up because, oh, he kind of looks like Jesus. That was when the Bible told us. When it says, like Joseph, so is Jesus, you know? So you can go back there and you read Joseph again. So the same thing here in Hebrews 9, it's telling us. You know that old tabernacle back there? Well, God was telling us something about the new one. Oh, go back there and read Exodus 40, you know, 30 through all those boring chapters in Exodus about the sockets and the stones and everything to see how they built that, because apparently it's telling us something. Some people even think, and this is, again, speculation because it doesn't speak specifically to this, that this tabernacle is a picture of the universe and how God created all things. And how he, when Genesis 1, he created all things, he expanded the universe, and you've got a holy place and this sort of thing. And so they kind of flip it up like this or on the side and say, this is the earth. Some people say this is the earth, and then this is the second heaven, and this is the third heaven, the most holy place where God's at. And that's kind of how they interpret this. Well, do your own study on that. Hebrews 9 says nothing about that. But be careful when we're interpreting some of these things. So stick with the scripture. Hebrews 9, verse 8 says, the Holy Ghost, this signifying... And then he explains what this meant. Now, I can pause before continuing here. When it says the Holy Ghost thus signifying, what's that telling us? Who wrote the Old Testament? God would be the answer. Right? But here it says specifically the Holy Ghost. When we describe all this stuff, the Holy Ghost was signifying. Some people have the idea that, you know, God the Father was in the Old Testament, and then Jesus and the Holy Spirit came later. Well, there was service that they did later, but all three persons are in the Godhead forever. They're all God. And so here's a verse that tells us the Holy Ghost was back there signifying something when he inspired the scripture in the book of Exodus, okay, in Deuteronomy. Anyway, that was a side note. Verse 8 says, the Holy Ghost signifying that the way into the holiest of all was not yet made manifest while as the first tabernacle was yet standing. So what does all this mean? What does all this description mean? Well, it simply means that the better way, the better tabernacle, the way into the most holy place was not yet known. They didn't know it. And so for all those years that Israel's performing this service and that God ordained that they do this, there was not a knowledge of how to get into this access to God, right? There was no knowledge of it. They didn't know. All they knew was they couldn't go in there or else they'd die, you see. And the high priest went in once a year and offered some blood and this sort of thing. So the Holy Ghost is signifying by this veil that they couldn't cross over, that the way into there was unknown. Right, and this is significant. Of course, John 14:6, Jesus comes, and what does he say? I am the way. Right? Everyone's going, the way where? Well, where are you going, Jesus? And that was constantly the question his disciples asked him. Well, he's talking about this, obviously, right? I am the way. I am the truth. He's the way. He's the access to God, you see. He says, you want to come to the Father? Come to me, you see. You want to come to God? Come to me. That's why he kept saying that in the book of John, okay? And, of course, in Luke 23:45, what happens regarding that veil, which the Holy Ghost is signifying, blocked Israel from access to God, even though it was still Israel's tabernacle and Israel was chosen nation, Israel was Israel's God, that veil kept them from accessing him. Luke 23:45, what happened when Jesus died on that cross? It was about the sixth hour, and there was darkness over all the earth until the ninth hour, and the sun was darkened, and the veil of the temple was rent in the midst. So you've heard that before, and Matthew 26 says the same thing. When Jesus died, this curtain was split from top to bottom right in the middle. No one could go in there, you see. And Jesus died, it split. I think that signifies something. Of course, pastors have seen that very clearly, and the scripture has revealed that very clearly, that Jesus is the way. The way where? The way into that most holy place. The way to access God. You see, that was what Jesus was. And Hebrews simply expounds on that. So again, parenthetical statement. Hebrews is talking about nothing that is a mystery. He's simply the fulfillment of the Old Covenant and the New Covenant for Israel, right? I mean, this was all pictured in the Old Covenant, and Israel was promised to have access to God. Just how they were going to do that, they didn't know. But this is all stuff spoken since the world began. So Hebrews 9:8 says that they did not know, it was not made manifest, while as the first tabernacle was yet standing. So while they had this tabernacle, didn't know, okay? That's also prophetic in the sense that that temple in Jerusalem, not that tabernacle, but the temple in Jerusalem was going to be destroyed eventually. You know, and it was. The temple in Jerusalem was destroyed by the Romans. So in verse 9 it says, which was a figure for the time then present, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices that could not make him that did the service perfect, as pertaining to the conscience. So what it's saying here is that first we need to recognize these words. When it says in verse 9, it was a figure for the time then present. And then down in verse 10, if you see where it says, it stood in meats and drinks and diverse washings and carnal ordinances imposed on them until the time of Reformation. So there was a figure for that time, the time then present. Then there's a time of Reformation. And what should that tell us? There's different times. There's sundry times. There's dispensational change. What God was doing then can change. And it did for Israel. There's a time of Reformation, okay? And so whereas the Old Covenant in this tabernacle pictured an access, a limited access to God, and it goes on in Hebrews 9, verse 9 and 10 here to explain the sacrifice, how it says that the sacrifice could not make him that did the service perfect as pertaining to the conscience. What's that talking about? So the priests, when they came in here with their sacrifices, like they offered a sacrifice here and then came in here and offered a sacrifice, the high priest didn't have a perfect conscience. Now, it doesn't mean that when they offered the sacrifices, God didn't forgive their sins or anything like that. It simply means that he had to come in again next year, right? I mean, he was offering, after all, the blood of a goat or the blood of an animal. You know, you're like, God, I'm doing what you say, but I don't know how well this animal can really substitute for me, right? And so you see this imperfect conscience. You're doing what God says in the Old Testament, but I got to do it again next year. I got to do it again tomorrow morning with the incense. I mean, it never rests. It never satisfies in your own mind. Now, what if I were to say, well, you know what, priests of Aaron, instead of going every year, instead of going every day at the altar there and doing all that stuff, what if I just said one time for the rest of your life? You would suddenly go, that's a lot better. That's a lot better. Well, this is exactly what the New Covenant's talking about here. Instead of every year, okay, once, forever. And instead of an earthly tabernacle and worldly service with things that you could mess up, and we didn't offer it correctly, well, I'm going to offer it for you. And I'm going to do it exactly the way that God wants. Now, this is what Christ is doing. He's the priest. He's the sacrifice. He's fulfilling. He's perfect. He's without sin. You see, so this should bring confidence to these people that if we replace this with Christ, that's going to be a better sacrifice. Okay, your conscience about your sin is something that's affected by the quality of the sacrifice for your sin. Am I right? I mean, even today, the way people think about their sin, they think, well, I need to get right with God. Well, to the degree they think they need to get right with God affects their conscience, right? So, I mean, if I say, oh, get right with God, just give him a nickel, you'll be good. And if someone didn't know grace, they'd be like, a nickel, that's it? You know, I mean, wouldn't you think? I mean, I've sinned pretty bad. You know, what about two nickels? You know, I mean, some people would think, well, you know, my conscience, you know, it needs a better sacrifice than that. And this is the same idea with the Old Testament, where, you know, you got these animals, you got once every year, but you know, for the whole nation, this is it. And so you need a far better sacrifice to make your conscience perfect about, okay, that's a worthy sacrifice for my sin. I mean, I think that'll work. Okay, you can give the illustration. I told you about my burnt offerings in the kitchen before. You know, whereas if I were creating a burnt offering for you, and I said, well, here's something. It's my burnt offering. You know, it's the first time I ever made it. Never tried this before. New kind of cuisine for me. Here you go. What kind of confidence would I have that you would like it, or even that you would have that it would be acceptable? All right, we like Justin, we'll try it, you know, but we don't have a high hopes for this. Okay, imperfect conscience, right? But what if I had a recipe that I had made 1,000 times, or more so than that, I had won awards for this recipe. I mean, what's her name, Betty Crocker? I mean, she just gave me a golden cake for what I do, you know. This is the best recipe. America's voted it, hands down, best recipe. You've never had it. And I say, here it is, the best recipe voted by America. I mean, this is it. No flaws. Now, what kind of hope would I have that you're going to like it? You're going to be acceptable to you. Well, I'm going to think, well, they're going to like this. I mean, I'm going to have every confidence that this is going to be a worthy offering, and you're going to like it because, you know, it's the best. You see. And again, this is a mundane example of Christ and his sacrifice. And that there was these animals, these goats they offered frequently, and that they were often dirty. I mean, animals are lower than men. And there was this, you know, this is not satisfying God. And we had to continually do this. But when Christ comes without sin, he's God manifest in the flesh, and he offers himself, that's a better sacrifice. And they can have confidence in him and in his sacrifice and in his service that it's acceptable to God once forever. You see, so that's the idea. And so Hebrews 9 says that the Old Covenant had limited access to God. The Old Covenant had imperfect sacrifices, thus their consciences were not satisfied. And then thirdly, the service that they did was temporary. I mean, they had to go in frequently to these things. I mean, it wasn't once and done. They're doing it all the time. So their service was continual, okay? It was temporal, all right? It was carnal in this way. Rather than that, in Hebrews 9 in verse 11, it talks about what Christ has done. It says, that's what was the old covenant, but Christ, Hebrews 9 verse 11, but Christ being come a high priest of good things to come by a greater and more perfect tabernacle not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building, neither by the blood of bulls, of goats rather, and calves, but by his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. So, if the problem with the Old Covenant was they had limited access And they had an imperfect conscience because of the low quality of sacrifice they were offering, even though they tried to find a heifer without spot and they tried to find the perfect lamb. I mean, it's still just a lamb after all. And it was carnal and temporary. Okay, all things that are carnal are temporary. And so if these were the problems, temporary, there we go. If these were the problems with this first tabernacle, and it says, but Christ, the new covenant, excels, it's better than that. And it's better than that in these ways. Okay, this access which was forbidden, suddenly Christ performs. I mean, that earthly tabernacle, that was on the earth. Okay, that's on the earth. I mean, the same dirt that everyone else is living on, that Ark of the Covenant is in that temple. I mean, saying a sanctified place, but it's still on the dirt. And they're trying to access God, the God of heaven and earth. What's Christ do when he dies? Floats up off the earth, and he goes up to heaven. Well, it seems like if you're going to access God, meeting him on his own turf, it'd be a lot closer than trying to find him in a 15 by 15 cubit space on the earth. You see, so does he have access? Sure does. He went to heaven, a heavenly tabernacle, a greater tabernacle, not made with hands. What does Paul say in Acts 17 to the Athenians? God does not dwell in buildings and temples made with hands. Well, he did for Israel, right? But he spoke a truth in that God doesn't need a tent to live in, right? God's in heaven. Christ came from heaven, John chapter 3, verse 16, and when he died, he went back to heaven. And he didn't just go there like returning home. He went back there to provide and prepare a place for Israel to access God and offer himself a sacrifice, which is the second thing here. Okay, whereas the blood of bulls and goats and the calves and things, it was imperfect, and thus their conscience was imperfect, and the people couldn't be made perfect by those sacrifices. Christ's sacrifice is much better. Okay, he offered himself a sacrifice. He was a man after all. He wasn't an animal, he was a man like the rest of us, right? Yet without sin, so he's a perfect man, right? And he offered his own blood on the heavenly altar. So if he's a perfect sacrifice, is this ease your conscience, more confident now? The answer would be yes, okay? And of course, the third thing, which Hebrews 9 deals with, is the temporary nature, where they had to repetitively do it. And we'll study next week how it talks about the priest, how they had to continually go in there time after time after time. But Christ, he went into heaven once and offered a sacrifice. So he went into heaven once, offered a perfect sacrifice, and that is a better system than this old system. That's a better service than the old service. It's a better sanctuary access, right? It's a better service with a better sacrifice. It's a better priest and ministry. It's a better mediation. It's just better all around, right? And that's what Hebrews 9 is dealing with here. Hebrews chapter 9 in verse 10. I got to pause here for a moment to address this, because it says that the reason why they couldn't be made perfect pertaining to their conscience when they did the service of the sacrifices and the gifts, it's because they only stood in meats and drinks and diverse washings. I mean, water, meats and drinks and things that they offered. I mean, bread in here, light, you know, incense. And that's what Paul says is not the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is not meat and drink, right? Does God need food? You got bread in here. Does God need it? No. Does God need you to light a lamp? No. I mean, see, these are all pictures. These are all things for their sake, you see. This is not, God doesn't need that. But they were doing him service because they told him to. And so these things, that's why their consciences were like, you know, God, you don't need this stuff. Why are you making us do this? Right? And so in verse 10, it stood only in meats and drinks, diverse washings. That diverse washings, by the way, here, there's baptisms. That's what that is. There were the washings in Israel mandated by law that it had to wash things, to clean them, to purify them. And so there were baptisms, washings in Israel's history. There were 12 of them in the scripture. These included water in Israel's religious service. Carnal ordinances imposed on them until the time of Reformation. There was a prophetic time of Reformation in which these things would change to a new way. Isaiah talks about it. Jeremiah talks about it. This time of Reformation, a change. The Bible always talked about a change of service. That's why Hebrews 7 says there was a change in the priesthood. So it was a necessity, a change in the law, Hebrews 7 verse 12. So there had to be a change. and that's what Reformation deals with. So when you hear about reformers or the Reformation, the Great Reformation in Christian history, that's not talking about the same thing. They spiritualize the scripture and make that be the same thing, but it's not. The Reformation here in church history has to do with the Roman Catholics in the 1500s and a group of Roman Catholics that split from them because they were trying to reform, clean up the church, the Roman Catholic Church. And so they were trying to get rid of all the excess when the Roman Catholics were selling forgiveness and things like this. You could pay for salvation. You could pay and then go and kill someone and be forgiven because you paid for it, you know. This was what the Roman Catholic Church was doing. So Martin Luther and others, they said, this is just wrong. And so they tried to reform it, and by so doing, they caused a split, and thus you had the Protestants who protested the church and the Roman Catholics. Reforming in that sort of way doesn't always work. In that way, it split. They split into two groups. Okay, a lot of grace people want to stay in their church that teaches not grace doctrine and try to reform it. Probably won't work because they believe they're doing things right, and you're sitting in the pew and you're not speaking from the pulpit, and so you don't reform it that way. The time of Reformation, when it happened for Israel, occurred when God himself came and changed the priesthood. So unless you're able to change the priesthood in someone else's church, most likely you're going to fail in your efforts to reform that church. Not to mention Hebrews 9 and this Reformation has nothing to do with our church today in the body of Christ. So just a word on Reformation. But Hebrews 9 verse 11 is the important passage here in the chapter when it deals with but Christ. There's the old things, but Christ being come a high priest of good things to come by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, neither by the blood of bulls and of goats rather and calves. I keep quoting Hebrews 10. He entered into once in the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption. Did I mention the third thing? Eternal redemption. So instead of temporary, it's eternal redemption, right? His access was greater. If you read Hebrews chapter 9, verse 24, it says, for Christ is not entered into the holy places made with hands, which are the figures of the true. So what a comfort for Israel. As they're being kicked out of Jerusalem and they can't enter the temple anymore, the book of Hebrews says, those are just figures. This thing that they're doing in Jerusalem, that service they're doing, the worldly sanctuary, those are just pictures. They're figures of the true. And the true is what your Savior, what the Messiah has done for you, is doing for you in heaven. It's the true. And so he entered into the true, into heaven itself. So what's the most holy place? Heaven. That's what Hebrews 9:24 says. So you see, this is where people get the idea of the tabernacle being a picture. The universe, because the most holy place, the place they couldn't enter, the place that man couldn't go, we're stuck on the earth, was heaven. And Jesus Christ went there, being from heaven. So he appears into heaven itself now to appear in the presence of God for us. That's interesting. What they put in this holy place? Bread. Show bread. That means bread shown in the presence of God. Jesus says, I am the bread of life. And he goes into heaven. apparently, his body, right? He offers his blood as well in Luke when he says, this is my blood of the New Testament. And he offers that. So he appears in the presence of God for the Hebrews. In Hebrews 9 verse 26, it says that he, down in verse 25, it says, nor yet that he should offer himself often as the high priest enters into the holy place every year with the blood of others, for then must he have often suffered since the foundation of the world. But now, once, in the end of the world, hath he appeared to put away sins by the sacrifice of himself. So we have that first appearing where he accesses heaven. The second appearing, when he goes into there once and he has a sacrifice that's better, okay, to put away sins by the sacrifice of himself. And then down in verse 28, you see this third appearing where, so Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many, and unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation. So that's their future hope. Okay, that's this. That's their salvation being complete. So he's went into heaven and he appeared before God in heaven to offer a better sacrifice, and he's going to promise them salvation in Hebrews 9 verse 28. For those that, what's it say? For those that look for him to come. So if they have faith in him, they do his commandments, they're going to have salvation when he comes again. Okay? Look at one more combination of verses and we'll stop for tonight. Hebrews 9, verse 12. The difference between the new covenant and the old covenant was that the old covenant was temporary. The new covenant was eternal. The new covenant is salvation for Israel. The old covenant could not save anybody. The old covenant, by the law, is the knowledge of sin, Romans 3:20. Galatians 2:16, Paul says, by the law is no flesh justified. Hebrews 10, verse 4 actually says, it is not possible that the blood of bulls and goats should take away sins. It's not possible. So, wow. I mean, how many bulls and goats offered back there? And God told them to do so for forgiveness. And so God knew that and knew their hearts and their faith. But Hebrews 10, 4 says, it's not possible. That should happen. So it was of necessity. It was required that a better service be offered. It was required that this is a picture. This is not the real thing. This is a picture of the real thing. Okay? And so back in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 12, rather, it says that when he went into the holy place in heaven, he obtained eternal redemption for us. Eternal redemption. Okay? In Hebrews 9, verse 14, it says, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? He says that the blood of bulls and goats sanctifies and purifies the flesh when their blood is sprinkled on the altar. If that purified your mind temporarily, right, back in the Old Testament. If you go to the Catholic priest and you say, forgive me, Father, he says 10 Hail Marys, and you do it, and you're like, oh, I'm good till the next time. If that does it temporarily, how much more would you think that the blood of Christ through the eternal Spirit offered in heaven without spot, how will that purge your conscience? Roman Catholic, right? Christ offered your sacrifice. He offered the blood. He was born of Mary. You don't need to confess to a priest anymore. You have one priest, and that's Christ. And that's if I were talking as Israel. In the dispensation of grace, I'd say, Christ is not your priest, he's your head. He's offering your grace. So at Hebrews chapter 9, verse 14, the eternal Spirit. So he has eternal redemption obtained for Israel. He has an eternal Spirit, so it's not just a man who's going to die and cease. It's eternal, his offering. His work is eternal. Then Hebrews 9, verse 15, we'll cover this next week. For this cause he is the mediator of the New Testament, that by means of death, for the redemption of the transgressions that were under the First Testament, they which are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance. Eternal inheritance. When we be taken away. Forever. Eternal redemption. Not just temporary redemption. And they have to go back under bondage. Eternal redemption. Okay? Not multiple sacrifices, but an eternal offering by an eternal Spirit. An eternal inheritance. This is what the new covenant provides for Israel. So you see, this is a much better covenant for Israel, all wrapped up in Christ's work. If they would simply look for him to return in Hebrews 9:28, if they would simply obey him and labor toward him in Hebrews 4, they can receive these promises. Right? In Hebrews 6, it says that. So we'll stop there this week and pick up Hebrews 9:15 next week, since it's a pretty big subject there in those three or four verses. Any questions about the comparison between the worldly sanctuary and how the work of Christ for Israel is far better in heaven? No question, you're good. This should make it clear for you as well, as we're studying through Hebrews, how, you know where Paul says that we're able ministers of the New Testament? I mean, this should make it clear. I mean, the things that we're learning here, that this is better than that, I mean, we already know that by grace. I mean, it's old hat for grace. The only different language here is that it's put into a religious system, priests, temple, sacrifices, right? So it's showing in their, if their language in that setting, how this is a picture of that. But under grace, we already know we're all sinners. We already know that we need Christ. We can't do it on our own, right? That's what Paul deals with. But, you know, for Israel in a religious system, they needed to be explained how this is a better priest, better sacrifice. All right, any thoughts? So we can definitely minister this to Jews who are questioning, you know, Paul saying, Paul, it sounds like you're saying we don't need temple, priest, or anything at all. Of course, Paul would go, yeah, you're right. But what could he do with these Jews? He could say, that's because I'm talking about a better thing. You know, I mean, those bulls and goats, it's not possible that they pay for sins. And so you could definitely explain Hebrews 7, 8, 9 to a Jew. And it would help them understand how that was a picture, this is better, and now they're at Christ. And so now you only simply have to explain how in this dispensation, the new covenant's not yet fulfilled, and he's offering grace freely to all. So anyway, this is how Hebrews 9 can be helpful for us, talking with those who are stuck in a religious system, because it helps us understand how Christ is much better than that. All right. Lord, we thank you for your teaching and your word through Hebrews 9. And I thank you for the pictures and the figures that you gave us through the Old Testament. And I pray that it would educate us and edify us so that we are able to explain when we meet those who are stuck in religion, how that whether it be your program of salvation for Israel or your offer of salvation to the church today, you are at the center point of it all. You are above all things and the head of all things, and you are the reason it all works. And so we thank you for your Son, Jesus, and what he's provided for us freely by your grace to save us from our sins. Amen. Thank you, folks.